Good evening and welcome to White House History Live. My name is Dr. Matthew Costello and I am Vice President and Interim Director of the David M. Rubenstein National Center for White House History. Before we begin this evening's program, I would like to briefly share more about who we are and our organization. White House Historical Association was founded in 1961 at the request of First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy and has worked with every administration since to preserve and protect the White House, its collection, and the history within its walls. We are a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization with a mission to educate Americans about the history of the Executive Mansion, as well as the people who worked and lived there. We cannot carry out our mission without the generous support of our donors, members, followers, and you, the viewers. On behalf of everyone at the association, thank you for your support, and I hope you enjoy tonight's program. Tonight, we will explore the origins and outcomes of one of America's most overlooked wars, the War of 1812, as well as the story behind the infamous burning of Washington, D.C. Joining us is Dr. Robert Watson, Professor of History at Lynn University. He is an author, historian, media commentator, and community activist. He joined the faculty of Lynn in 2007 after spending 15 years teaching at universities around the country. He has published over 45 books and approximately 200 scholarly articles, essays, and chapters on a variety of topics in history and politics. His recent books, America's First Crisis, The Nazi Titanic, The Ghost Ship of Brooklyn, George Washington's Final Battle, which I particularly enjoyed, and Escape, have all received critical acclaim. Robert, welcome to White House History Live.
Thank you, Matt, and it's good to be here to the audience. Thank you for tuning in and supporting the White House Historical Association. They're doing very important work, and it's a pleasure to be on with you, Matt. We have had the pleasure of knowing you for several years. You wrote a wonderfully nice endorsement of my book on George Washington, and you and I have that in common. Matt wrote an awfully good book on George Washington, and we're both fans of the first president. So thank you, Matt.
You're very welcome. And here it is right here. Tonight we'll be talking about when Washington burned. Now, before we jump in, just a reminder to all watching, if you have any questions for Robert, please type them in the comments section in the live feed, and we will try to answer as many questions as we can once we finish our discussion. So let's pull up our PowerPoint. And Robert, I think it makes sense that we would start with the origins of the War of 1812. How and why did this conflict come about?
Well, you're right, Matt. It's the overlooked, forgotten war, sandwiched between the Revolution and the Civil War. It's kind of the middle kid, I guess you could say. Harry Truman called this war the silliest damn war we ever fought, end quote. And he was right. It was almost as if the Keystone Cops had planned the war. So there were several causes of the war. The main one was impressment. What this was Napoleon and the British, when Napoleon was running amok for years in Europe in the early 1800s. And while Napoleon had arguably the most powerful army at the time, the British had the most powerful navy at the time. So one of the ways to defeat Napoleon was to build a massive navy and blockade ports all across Europe. That would prevent Napoleon from exporting, importing, moving his troops. But to do that, you need an awful lot of wood, you need an awful lot of ships, and you need an awful lot of sailors. So there was a notion in Britain back in the early 1800s, you know, once one of His Majesty's, servants, always part of His Majesty's servants. What the British did was they would simply pull over American, typically New England, merchant craft, fishing craft, and press, that is, conscript the fishermen, the merchants off the ships. So these impressment gangs armed and on a warship would pull up, and a merchant ship or fishing boat had no chance whatsoever. We're not sure the number of Americans that were pressed in the service, but I estimated that about 12,000 in the early 1800s were pressed, which means virtually every community in New England had a son, a brother, a father who was pressed. So that was one of the reasons for the war. Real quickly, some Southerners wanted to expand slavery and were looking at gobbling up new territory. Some expansionists and imperialists were looking at seizing Canada. And there was the matter of the quote unquote Indian question. There was some hawkish move to push the indigenous folks off their ancestral lands. And the war gave everyone cover for that. James Madison, the president, didn't want the war, knew we weren't ready for the war. But in the midterm election of 1810, a bunch of Southern and frontier hawks who did not respect the revolutionary generation or the, I guess, the protocols and norms of Congress, they came to power and pushed us into this war, which we really didn't need to fight. We were ill prepared to fight. And thus, we had the War of 1812.
Now, before we get to the burning of Washington, there was, and I think most Americans are unaware of this, there was another consequential burning that predated that in Canada. Can you tell us a little bit more about that episode?
Yeah, so that was in April of 1813. So the War of 1812 is a misnomer. It's named for 1 year, but it was fought for 2.5 years. The war technically ends with the Treaty of Ghent in Europe on Christmas Eve of 1814. The last major battle was January 8, 1815 in New Orleans, Andrew Jackson. So in April of 1813, we mounted a large flotilla of warships, and we sailed for the capital at the time of Upper Canada, which was York, today Toronto. And there it is. There's the fort. Small community by any standards, a frontier community, coastal community. What the problem was is we had mounted several attempts to invade Canada, and a few Canadians, a few British soldiers, and a few native allies whooped these larger American armies every time, even if we had a 2, 3, 5, 10 to 1 advantage. So there was a lot of pent up frustration. We also had cowardly generals. One named General Hall, the troops called him Granny Hall, because before he even saw the enemy, he would fold and go back to the fort. But we finally found a good commander, General Zebulon Pike. Everybody's heard of Pike's Peak. He was the young lieutenant who was on that discovery mission that found Pike's Peak, traced a number of rivers to their origin and so forth. At any rate, Zebulon Pike was a good general, a tough guy. Soldiers respected him, a disciplinarian. So he arrives and we attack the fort at York and make quick work of it. The British are running, the local militia groups are running. And as Zebulon Pike is sitting outside of the fort negotiating a surrender with some of the British, a cannonball from one of our naval ships launches into the fort, hits the arms depot, ignites the powder, and creates a giant eruption. More men were killed in that eruption than were killed in the battle. Blew the fort outward, knocked over trees, and it sent a large boulder hurtling in the air. A physician on hand, a surgeon, said it was the size of a harpsichord, and it landed on Zebulon Pike's head, killing him instantly. With Pike gone, some cowardly officers and angry soldiers vented their frustration by burning the Canadian capital. So there was always this notion that payback would come, and a year later it did.
So who were some of the key leaders, both on the British side and the American side, who played a role in the burning of Washington, D.C.?
The main two British commanders, General Robert Ross and Admiral Cockburn, George Cockburn, they couldn't have been more different. Ross, and you're looking at him, is a dashing fellow. He's a hero. He's by the book military, a gentleman, and wants to fight a wise war. Cockburn, the admiral, is a hothead. There he is. He's from an old distinguished line of admirals and sailors. He's a hothead. He had been part of the revolution, had lost relatives in it, and wanted payback. So these two are diametrically opposed. And they land in a late summer of 1814 in Eastern Shore, Maryland, and they're marching. They're not sure their ultimate objective. They're still getting orders. They're contemplating either Baltimore or Washington. Now, it may seem counterintuitive, but Baltimore is the far more enticing target. It's a big city. Fort McHenry is there, which is a massive fort by our standards. Armaments are there. Weaponry's there. A rich fishing fleet. and a lot of privateers who attacked and harassed the British, whereas Washington was a backwater. So while they're marching, Ross wants to do the more gentlemanly thing. Coburn wants to hit Washington. So those are two of the commanders. Two Americans, Armstrong was the Secretary of War, and William Winder was a general. These two guys were incompetent, as incompetent as they were cowardly. When the British are heading later toward Baltimore, Winder tells the people of Baltimore, as you leave, as you run away and evacuate, just don't panic, rather than staying and fighting. Armstrong, even though British warships are prowling the Chesapeake and the Potomac, you know, within just a short march of Washington, he says that they would never attack Washington, D.C., even when a large British expeditionary force under Ross, about 4,500 men, and this is the army that beat Napoleon, so these are the best of the best. Even when they landed in eastern Maryland, Armstrong says they would never attack Washington. President Madison gives him orders multiple times to prepare his defenses. It's shocking, but he literally does nothing. The day that the attack is occurring, he's still back in Washington saying they won't attack. And they're just, the British army's outside the city on its way in. So unfortunately, we were plagued by having two of the most incompetent cowards in American history handling our defenses at the time. And boy, did they get it wrong.
Boy, tell me how you really feel.
Yeah, it's hard to say anything good about either of these guys, Matt. They literally dropped the ball at every turn. I can't think of a single thing they did to prepare for the invasion.
Well, and if I can follow up with that one. So let's talk a little bit about Madison's role then, because he must have known after giving multiple orders that these guys were not carrying forward the directives or the duties of the office. So why isn't Madison doing more to replace them or, you know, to change command?
You know, Madison was, as you well know, given your scholarship and your work, Madison was a great framer, a great founder, you know, a constitutional expert, an impressively brilliant fellow. As a president, I think it's a mixed record. And you've seen all the presidential ranking polls. He's not a great or above average. He's, you know, middling to slightly above average, which is probably charitable, if anything. Madison could be weak and could be pushed around. He was pushed around by the war hawks in his own party. He ordered Armstrong and Winder multiple times. They did nothing, yet he did not remove them from command. James Monroe is the Secretary of State. Monroe is one of the few cabinet officers that's doing something. Monroe, out of frustration, mounts a horse and rides to the eastern shore of Maryland, and he's shadowing the British Army as they're marching, dispatching notes a couple times a day saying that they're coming. So Monroe's doing something. Madison goes out into the field with the Army and Monroe to try to find the British. Of course, we didn't have GPS at the time or aerial surveillance. And Madison and the Army, they're out looking for the British as the British are marching in. Belatedly, Madison tried that after the fact he would fire Armstrong, his Secretary of War, and have Monroe fulfill both jobs. But yeah, Madison drops the ball on this for sure.
You know, in the book, you talk a little bit about the lead up to the burning, the skirmishes that were sort of unfolding between the British and the Americans. Is there any one that comes to mind that you think was particularly important?
Important one was at Bladensburg in Maryland, just a few miles outside of Washington. So there you can see it on the map. So it's a stone's throw from the city. Bladensburg is where the armies met. Madison finally met them, and we set up defenses there. We had just over 6,000 men. The British had an army of 4,500, but the advance force is between 1,000 and 2,000. So we have vast numerical superiority. However, when General Ross, the British commander, marches to Bladensburg, he looks out with a spyglass and he sees the Americans are in poor formations, mismatched uniforms, mismatched weaponry. And he sees, oh, there must be militiamen or just, you know, quick recruits. There were government clerks. There were militiamen from a couple states. So he realized the command structure was weak. So rather than wait for the rest of his army to catch up, Ross attacks. And he starts with Congreve rockets. That's the rockets bursting in air, you know, like a fireworks. They're not a much of an effective weapon in terms of destruction. It's more of a weapon of terror. And sure enough, mm-hmm. when he fires the Congreve rockets, a lot of our men drop their guns and run like hell. Mm-hmm. So it's an embarrassing defeat. In fact, Madison is almost trampled when he's behind the army by the fleeing army, marking only one of two times when a president is within a war zone during a combat. Madison and then Lincoln in July of 1864, when a group of rebels were going to attack Washington, D.C. Lincoln's almost shot. But the British overrun us. One of the few Americans to stay and fight was a naval commodore named Joshua Barney, who had some Marines, some sailors, some former slaves who were working with him, and they dug in and they fought. Their heroism held Ross's army off long enough for our men to retreat. Otherwise, the casualty counts would have been enormous because it was a chaotic, mad dash from the battlefield. So that was the main one. That's Joshua Barney there. He had this flying navy, if you will, these barges. It took too long for us to build ships. It would take months and months and months at a Navy yard. Meanwhile, the British are coming. And so Barney says, why don't we just put a gun, a cannon, if you will, on a barge, row it out like a bunch of, mosquitoes attacking a bear, right? Or bees or hornets attacking a larger animal. And he would race out. They would fire a few shots and then race back to the protection of the low tide and estuaries and whatnot. So Barney was harassing the British. And when the British were landing, Barney had no choice. So he ordered his men to drag the artillery, the naval guns, and they put up a stingy defense. Barney was shot, wounded, and both Ross and Coburn were so impressed with his stingy defense that as the Americans were running, they came up to visit Barney and make sure they got medical attention. They were so inspired by his heroism. And then Ross delivers this great line that they couldn't follow the American army because we ran like, oh, there's Barney on the ground and the British commanders. Ross kneeled down, Coburn standing, visiting Commodore Barney and just impressed with his heroism. He stood his ground to the last man. But Ross says something to the effect of the Americans ran like sheep before wolves. And he says, we would have given chase, but the day was too hot and, my men were too exhausted. I was exceptionally hot and dry at that particular point of the battle, which was early on August 24th, 1814.
So I think one of the most famous anecdotes or stories that come from the War of 1812 is the rescue of the Gilbert Stuart portrait. And for generations, Americans were taught that Dolly Madison saved this portrait, sometimes just saved it herself. Saved it with assistance of others, but really that she was primarily, she was the person responsible for this. However, this episode is much more complicated than that. Tell us a little bit more about the portrait rescue. And then I think beyond that, what was Dolly's role in shaping that story post 1814?
Yeah, there's a lot of variations of the story, as you correctly noted, Matt. And historians believe some of them are apocryphal, they're fancied, made up. But there is probably some truth. What we do know is Dolly Madison did stay back at the White House. The president, as I noted, was out in the field with the soldiers. He posted a colonel and about 100 men to protect the White House. She looked out the window and wrote that they all ran. She was livid. At one point, she even writes that she was upset to see everybody fleeing. And she writes to a half-sister saying, if the ladies and I had enough cannons, we would have rolled one out every window of the building and defended the building. You know, as I do, that the letters that she wrote about this were written well after the fact. And most historians believe they were cleaned up a bit. There was the wonderful Gilbert Stuart portrait of Washington in black, holding out an arm, this hand, a priceless portrait. However, this was a copy. This wasn't an original. And the story goes that before she left, she ordered it be taken down. And here you can see a young slave. His name was Paul Jennings. He would have been maybe 13 or 14 if memory serves. So he's a little older in this painting. There was a young slave girl, probably depicted there in green. A guy named French John, who was the butler. And then two local men with a wagon came up. So a handful of them. She ordered that the painting not be torn out, but rather the story says the frame was hit with an axe, and then she wouldn't even let him roll up the portrait, the painting, lest it be damaged. And then it was put on a wagon, and only at the 11th hour, as she's looking with a spyglass as the British are approaching, does she flee, risking her life to save history. You know, and the truth is somewhere in there. The letter, the famous letter, was written for a well-to-do socialite years later who wanted to publish a book of Washington's history, and Dolly sort of reimagined it. But it does serve a purpose. And you know better than I or anybody, given your work on American memory, it served to forge the nation insofar as the citizenry, dejected, returns to Washington, you know, heads held low, the cities burned out. We were embarrassingly whooped by the British. We ran. But this story of the beloved First Lady, she was the hostess with the mostest. People love Dolly Madison. The beloved First Lady risks her life, saves the portrait of the father of our country, wants to move back into the White House. You know, that's the kind of story that that provides a narrative, one of these founding myths, I suppose, that are essential for a sense of national pride and identity.
Yeah, I mean, I do think you mentioned earlier the presidential rankings, and I've always been sort of perplexed that Madison is as high as he is, considering he was president when the nation's capital was torched. But I do think a big part of that has been not only people choosing to remember him more as father of the Constitution, but also that I think Dolly, you know, plays a big role in this, not only keeping the Capitol in Washington, but also really promoting this very aspirational patriotic narrative that people can get behind, right? There's not many positives that come out of the War of 1812, but this is one of those positive stories.
I'm with you 100%. I agree with everything you just said, and from the presidential rankings through to creating this narrative about it. You know, Madison was brilliant and a great founder, and we you and I would both agree on that. And I agree with you, overrated as a president. But kind of a, you know, an academic stick in the mud. They called him the Great Little Madison, our smallest president. Dolly was charismatic, interesting, feisty. Sometimes wore low-cut tops, too much makeup. She had a peacock plumes in one of her hats. She wore a purplish turban. So she would, like every family has an aunt like that, right, Matt? she was that aunt, right?
You say they're a personality, right? It's a personality.
You know, yeah. I'm a Dolly Madison fan. I like her. Absolutely, I do. And she's irresistible. So I do think that was an essential story for licking our wounds and rebuilding after this horrible incident. Think about it. The British, you know, came close to occupying our capital. They sacked it. They didn't have enough men to fully occupy it, but had they had a larger force, that could have changed American history. And especially as they were invading, it was a three-pronged invasion. The central prong hit us at the Potomac, then one coming down from Canada and one up from New Orleans. If they had been successful in all three, and they had been successful for, you know, a year plus before that, this would have been a different history for the United States.
So your book mentions several other figures who rescued items of national importance. Yes, there are the Dolly Madisons, but there are also the clerks. I know in particular, you talk a bit about Stephen Pleasanton, but if you talk about him, talk about anyone else, you know, there's other people who also acted decisively that evening.
Certainly, thanks for that. So, yeah, there were a handful of government clerks who worked in the House, the Senate, and the Library of Congress, which was in the Capitol at the time. And with the British force on its way, every able-bodied man was sent out, handed a musket and sent out, including government clerks. One of them was Stephen Pleasanton, a young clerk in his 20s. Pleasanton has an, there he is, late in life. Pleasanton has an officer named Colonel Magruder, whose brother was the Librarian of Congress, but a real scoundrel, corrupt and incompetent. It was one of those political appointments, friends with Jefferson kind of a thing. But at any rate, Stephen Pleasanton is begging Magruder to let him go. He wants to go back to the Capitol. And Magruder's threatening to court-martial him. finally, it appears that Pleasanton just tires him out. And Magruder says, well, then go get. He races back to the Capitol. And what he does is he collects our national treasures. And he and a handful of other young clerks save the Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, the Bill of Rights. And they can't find wagons. They can't find carriages because everybody in the city had fled. They can't find horses. They're scouring the countryside to find an ox or maybe an old cart with two wheels. And they're, you know, hitching it up and moseying slowly out of the city with these artifacts in the back, literally as a massive British army is marching on another road into the city. And by the very end of the day, they can see the cloud of dust kicked up by a few thousand boots marching on that parched land into the city. So Pleasanton renders our nation an invaluable service by saving all these artifacts, which then, as you correctly note, and part of your scholarship, helped to create this memory and this narrative to rally the people. Sadly, he stays and spends his whole life working as an archivist and clerk, and he wants to be promoted. He's never promoted. He never gets to be the Librarian of Congress or a senior clerk. So he kind of toils away in obscurity, his story and heroism and thoughtfulness long forgotten. So I dedicated the book to Stephen Pleasanton and these other nameless, forgotten young clerks. I think I got the names of about five that we can confirm were helping, but others know. So yeah, I'm a big fan of his, of what he did as an historian. You and I would be a kindred soul. We'd be back there packing that that wagon with artifacts with Stephen Pleasanton.
Well, I mean, it's fascinating because really, even this idea of like Americans having a sense of historical consciousness hadn't really fully taken root. But for these, you know, junior clerks to be the ones who are like, we need to save as many of these things as possible, not just to keep the government going, but for posterity, you know, it's a fascinating part of the book.
Absolutely. Okay. They also had, he made satchels out of linen and was stuffing them. And they rode miles and miles all night long and went to some little town and hid him in a barn. And then he and others just literally fell asleep in a boarding house. They were so exhausted. And then there they sat in a barn, one fire away from being lost, one British, you know, curious soldier who would happen upon it, and they would have been lost. But there they sat for weeks until Pleasanton and others came back and fetched them and took them back to the, you know, the burned out city. So what a precarious moment.
Well, you know, it is White House History Live. So I think we got to just kind of pull the Band-Aid off and just get it over with. So let's talk about the invasion, the burning of the public buildings, and the burning of the White House. How did the British go about doing this, and how effective were these methods?
So the British, Ross and Cockburn, the general and admiral, with a smaller advance force, march into the city at around sunset, a little after sunset, on August 24th, 1814. He stops and suppers in a boarding house, and the woman that comes out that's the owner, he's kind of, you know, poking her, if you will, by saying that he knew all about the city because he sent a spy there earlier and she gave him information. She cooked him dinner. At any rate, what they do is they march to the Capitol and then the White House. Then over, you know, a number of hours, they would burn the War Department, now the Defense Department, the State Department, the Treasury Department, the Navy Yard. So several of the most important public buildings, starting with the Capitol. He had soldiers carrying torches and devices that were burning with oil. So they launched the torches up onto the roof to try to burn the Capitol and the White House, but the roof didn't catch. So they went inside and piled up furniture and then lit it. Now it happened to have been very, very dry for days before that. So everything was parched. And it was windy, as you can see from that depiction. The winds whipped up the flames, and eyewitness accounts, and I have a couple of them their diaries I quoted in the book. Eyewitness accounts describe the wind whipping through the windows of the Capitol and then later the White House and whipping back in until the entire building was engulfed with flames. So they used torches. They threw them on the roof. They had pots of oil that they threw in. They used some of the powder from those Congreve rockets that I talked about earlier to spark the flames and burned out those public buildings. They did not attack private residences. The few citizens remaining in the city, he had them gather and announce to them that if they don't attack the British, he will not attack their homes. So he made good on his word there. Mm.
So the British don't stay in DC very long. They sort of achieve their main objective. And then less than 3 weeks later, there is the siege of Baltimore. Tell us more about that campaign, its casualties, and of course, the bombing of Fort McHenry.
Yeah. So the British are only, you know, in the city overnight. First off, as I noted, they did not have enough men or artillery to hold the capital. You would need an army vastly larger than the 1,000 men in the advance or the 4,500 total. You would need a lot more artillery than a handful of small guns that they were dragging along behind them. So they didn't have the means to hold the city. They burned it, made their point, tried to embarrass the country, sow the seeds of dissent. And then they headed on to the far more important target of Baltimore. As I said, privateers, rich harbor, lots of ships, an important Fort McHenry that had a stockpile of weapons. Typical for the Americans at the time, we weren't prepared. McHenry was commanded by a guy named Armistead, who was only a major in his, I believe, mid to late 20s, young. And it wasn't fully garrisoned. Which is ridiculous, given that it's one of the most important forts in the area, defending one of the most important cities. So the British plan a two-pronged attack. Ross goes by land, and then the Navy sails by sea. Ross is going to come up and strike Baltimore by land. Now, as I said earlier, Winder, the cowardly, incompetent general, told people, when you flee, be careful to flee this way and don't run over one another, you know, don't hurt one another. But there were two old Revolutionary War guys, Smith and Stricker, sort of grumbly. They remind me of the old guys in the Muppets. And Smith and Stricker say, we're not going to leave the city. We're going to stay and fight. So what they do is they do a couple of things. They put a lot of lanterns out in the woods. So when the British at night target Baltimore, they hit the woods rather than the building. They order all lamps be snuffed out to make the city dark. They have bucket brigades. If a building is hit, to quick put out a fire. Then they commandeer the ships of the city and they sink them at the entrance to what today would be Inner Harbor by Fort McHenry, creating a gauntlet, a seawall of ships. So when the British arrive, they can't sail into the city. They have to drop anchor far outside the city and fire. Meanwhile, Ross is marching into the city and the last thing he expects is to be hit, to be attacked. And that's what happens. They send men out to attack Ross, and he rides forward. An aide comes up, and Ross says, I will sup in Baltimore, supper. I will sup in Baltimore tonight or in hell. And then as the front lines of his army are held up, an aide comes back and says, there's militia everywhere. And Ross says, I don't give a you know what if it's raining militia. And he races forward to inspire his men, and he's shot and killed. With Ross killed, the army was exhausted. They were tired from the heat. Also, when they were leaving Washington, there was a freakish storm. And there's various accounts. Some say just a horrendous wind. Others say one, maybe two tornadoes. Washington, D.C. doesn't get tornadoes, but a freakish storm. And one of the locals yelled that it wasn't a storm. It was the finger of George Washington coming down to, you know. So they were a bit superstitious, unnerved. With Ross dead, they didn't attack. So now the Americans only have to deal with the attack from sea. So what Armistead does is he knows a major force is coming. He has a massive flag built, a massive flag sewn by Mary Pickersgill, who was sort of the Betsy Ross of the War of 1812, a massive flag, which is now, as we all know, in the Smithsonian Museum of American History. Every time I'm in a city, I stop and see it. This flag is flying above the city to inspire, above the fort, rather, to inspire everybody. All night long, the British launch what is one of the largest bombardments ever at the time, literally all night long, firing hundreds, if not thousands, of rounds, firing Congreve rockets at Fort McHenry. Also, on board was a doctor named Beans, a Scotsman, who had actually helped treat some British soldiers, but spied on the British and was loyal to us. When the British found out he was doing that, they arrested him and put him on their flagship. which I believe was the HMS Tonnant. So he's being interrogated. And after the battle, they're going to probably sentence him to death for, you know, treason and espionage. However, Dr. Beans is well-liked, well-regarded. So people in the area get a very handsome lawyer and budding poet named Francis Scott Key to go out and try to negotiate for Dr. Beans's release. Key secures Dr. Beans's release, but not until the next morning. So all night long, they have to watch the bombs bursting in air, the rockets' red glare, right? And hope that our flag would still be there. And in the morning, they're so inspired that Key puts, you know, quill to parchment and writes a poem, which is later put to the song Old Anacreon in Heaven, a sort of a British tavern song, and that would become our national anthem. And in the morning, the flag is flying and Fort McHenry stood and the British sail away. So shockingly, Baltimore survived. And that was a turning point in the war in terms of inspiring Americans and giving us the victory that we so longed for.
Your book also touches on the debate to relocate the Capitol and the challenges with rebuilding the public buildings after the war. How did Americans overcome these obstacles?
Yeah, so Washington, D.C. was an unlikely location to begin with. When George Washington had this crazy idea of a grand city for the ages, and he was going to hack it out of the bogs and fields and forests where you're now sitting in Washington, it was a crazed idea. There were over 30 cities that put a bid in, I guess you could say, or were under consideration to one level of seriousness or another to be the capital. The most obvious choice would be Philadelphia. The other two large cities would be Boston and New York. But everything from Annapolis to, you know, you name it, was Baltimore was under consideration. But Washington says, no, we're going to hack it out of the fields and build a grand city anew, which was kind of crazy. So not a lot of people favored the location. Philadelphians wanted it there. A lot of New Englanders wanted it further north. The South was happy that it was at least in land ceded by Virginia and Maryland on the banks of the Potomac. Washington was happy because it was right next to his home and where he grew up. Sort of equidistance between the North and South, you know, with the Potomac, the Chesapeake, and it gives you access to the Atlantic. You need to build a city capital near water. Because of primitive transportation and rudimentary communications at the time. So it's never popular. So after the burning, this city was far from the majestic city where you are now, and the White House was far from the building that you preserve today, Matt. So there was not a lot of interest in rebuilding the city. This gave critics of the city the perfect excuse to move elsewhere. But Dolly Madison and others dug in and fought to keep the city in Washington. It was put up for a vote. And one of the early votes, it was a tie. The vote was within a few votes, one way or the other, of moving a motion forward to consider another city for the Capitol. So it was sort of congressional speak. But nonetheless, it came within just a few votes. But they rebuilt the city, and the grand city today almost didn't exist.
Hmm. All right. Now let's take some. We have quite a few questions coming in. So why don't we turn to the audience Q&A? David from Facebook asks, what are your thoughts on the Battle of Bladensburg? Who do you blame for the loss, the men or the incompetent leaders? Well, I think it's kind of a leading question, David, but go ahead, Robert.
All the above. Blame starts with Armstrong. He was the Secretary of War who was given a direct order by his commander, didn't do anything. Then the blame also belongs with Madison for not removing him and putting Monroe or someone else in charge. The blame also goes down to Winder in the field, who organized poor defenses, and all the way down to the line officers, you know, the men when they were in line. The British had to cross a river on a bridge, which was a natural choke point. We could have held them off with just a fraction of the men. But when the British shot Congreve rockets and stormed across the bridge, we folded and ran. So there was plenty of blame to go around. It's really a low point in American history. And then Barney, that naval commander, he races, even though he's been shot and he was bleeding out, he and some of his men race back to Washington to hope that the army's there to regroup. They want to try to save the city. They get back and find no one. So what they do is they spike a couple cannons in the city, which means to disable them. And they steal, I think, two small six-pounders, put them on a wagon, and leave. And everybody just kind of gave up. So that's really a low point in American military history, not even mounting a legitimate defense of our capital city.
Mm-hmm. Well, and you point out in the book, you know, this is sort of the culminating result of reductions, right? Reductions to the military, Navy spending. Jefferson and Jeffersonian Republicans, dating back to the Revolution, feared the idea of a standing army. And so when they came to power, that was one of the first things on the chopping block. But, you know, you remove those things and all of a sudden, and your book details this, you're asking states for troops, but they're not actually contributing to anybody. They're undersupplied. They have antiquated firearms. All of a sudden, it's kind of like, you know, the chickens come home to roost in a way.
Exactly. And you're right. Jefferson, during his 8 years as president, deserves some blame. He dismantled the military and did nothing for preparedness. And it does date back, as you correctly noted, to the Jeffersonian Republicans, that anti-government ideology, distrust of a big government or a strong standing military, even though we were vulnerable and the warning signs were everywhere. We fought the French in the quasi-war a few years before. We still had British forts on the Canadian border. There were still hostilities with the indigenous folks. To not be prepared, there's plenty of blame to go around.
Mm-hmm. Stephen from YouTube asks, where was the Washington portrait taken and when was it returned to the White House?
It was cut out of the frame. It was chopped out of the frame with an axe and not rolled up. It was laid on a wagon. There were two men who were friends of the Madisons who had obtained a wagon. Dolly gave them specific instructions to get it out of harm's way. So it was taken out of the city, several miles out of the city, and hid in a barn, sort of like the Declaration of Constitution. It was left there for a few weeks until they figured the threat from the British was no longer imminent. The British had moved down to New Orleans, the main army, to strike there, which they would strike there a couple months later. Then finally it was brought back, but it was not put up because the building was burned out, as you can see from this image here. So it didn't grace the walls for quite some time.
Yeah, the two men in question were Jacob Barker and Robert DePeyster. Yep. Who they later come about when there are multiple versions of the Portraits Rescue appearing in newspapers with the Carroll family and them telling Dolly to set the record straight and also to acknowledge their role in saving the portrait. Some interesting characters.
Yes.
Okay. Alyssa from Facebook asks, how much of the city did the British burn and where was the most damage?
Well, the Capitol and the White House were damaged. As we know, and Matt knows better than anybody given his job, but the White House would need to be reconstructed under Harry Truman. What was the old joke? The building was standing purely by habit, you know, with the foundation ruined, with a third floor and old wooden beams. It was literally sagging. I got to get there. There we go. This is literally sagging. Truman had talked about the chandelier swaying, some of the doors, the frames, the door didn't shut tight. So the White House was burned. Not irreparably. They didn't tear it down. They rebuilt around it. The Capitol was burned. The Treasury was burned. Probably the building that suffered the most damage was the Navy Yard, which we burned it. We burned the Navy Yard. The Commandant there and one young clerk named Mordecai were the ones who burned it, Mordecai Booth. They wanted to wait and wait and wait until the last minute. When word came that there was no defense of the city, they didn't want the ships that were being built in the Navy Yard, along with literally tons of tar, sails, wood, nails, everything you need to build and maintain a Navy. So they burned it themselves before the British could confiscate all that. They did sail a couple of real small, like schooners away, but they burned it. And as they were riding away, both of them left a written record looking back on the Navy Yards where they spent their careers in flames. So that one was totaled. The other ones were salvaged. But again, only one private building in a city was burned, but the rest of the private buildings were spared.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I would say, just based on the size, I mean, the Capitol Rotunda hadn't been constructed yet, right? So you had the Senate wing and the House of Representatives wing, and I think there was like a wooden connecting colonnade in between.
Yeah, the two. A wooden walkway and a wooden colonnade connected them. It wasn't the grand building that it is today.
But I think those two, I mean, those were the two largest, as far as I know, the two largest public buildings in the city. Yep. So probably in terms of the most damage done, the Capitol.
But there was
The White House was also demolished and needed to be rebuilt as well.
And there was a majestic, a large like timepiece statue that sat behind the speaker's chair of a bald eagle. They'd even killed a bald eagle and sent it to Europe, to the artisan, to get the bald eagle right. And the descriptions of it were that this piece was one of the most majestic things anybody had ever seen. And sadly, it was destroyed in the fires, along with the Library of Congress was lost, which was also an irreparable loss.
Mm-hmm. Let's see here. Denise from Facebook asks, I'm from DC and I heard that the circles were there to put in to confuse the British. Is that true?
No. So the original architect was Pierre Charles, aka Peter L'Enfant. He was French. He served during the war, so Washington and others trusted him. He served with honor. He was classically trained in Paris in both engineering and architecture, so he could design and build the city. He was a Mason, so Washington and all the Masons trusted him. He was also brilliant. He was also a megalomaniac and an egomaniac, so he would end up getting fired. But his design was inspired in part by Paris, where you have the naturally broad, wide boulevards and large public parks and roundabouts, like over by the Champs-Élysées. But it was also inspired by Washington, who wanted it to channel ancient Rome, you know, the grand boulevards that led to Rome. So one of the ideas was to bring these smattering of states together, as there would be large squares and public parks where the roads intersected, and those parks would be filled with memorials and monuments to our heroes and our fallen, to build a sense of national identity. When Washington was working on this, he said, we're in debt. We don't have a lot of architects. But one of the biggest problems was Washington said we lacked a sense of national identity. For example, if you could take a time machine back and meet Jefferson and ask Mr. Jefferson about his nation, he would answer Virginia. All this was designed, these big parks, to harken back to Paris, where L'Enfant was from, and to Rome, which was Washington's vision. So they were there for memorials and to give a sense of grandeur to this fledgling republic. So that was the reason.
Joan wonders, we hear about the Washington painting being saved, and you mentioned the Library of Congress and other documents. What about other important documents or works of art? Did the British loot them or burn them?
Yeah, one was a book. It was called the Book of Congress, and it was maintained by the Librarian of Congress, who did it on behalf of the Speaker of the House. And it had all the debates, votes, and details from the early Congresses. And Magruder, the Librarian of Congress, who I said earlier was inept, his brother was the colonel, he was inept and corrupt. It was a political appointment. He had no experience in that. He locked it in his desk. Then he claimed his health was bad. And as the British were, you know, threatening Washington, he went to basically a spa, to Hot Ponds, for some R&R. And these young clerks go down and they can't get into the desk. They don't have enough time to find something to break it with. And they're devastated that they can't get this book because it was an irreplaceable treasure. But there's so much else they have to get. So they're racing around. They save some British battle flags from the Revolution that we had captured when we were victorious, you know, Yorktown and elsewhere. But a lot of them were lost. It's hard to estimate the number of and the price of the artifacts that were lost. Think about, you know, you have a handful of clerks who only have a few hours and you know, a two-wheeled carriage pulled slowly by an ox. They're not getting everything out. So, you know, Pleasanton even was saying that he and others were running around deciding what to save and what not to save. What a heady responsibility.
Yeah, and I'll also just briefly speak to, on the White House side of things, Paul Jennings even makes note of this in his recollections that it wasn't really the British that you needed to worry about as much with the sacking as there were Americans who took advantage of the chaos and anarchy of what was happening. I think he describes a rabble breaking into the White House and making off with, I would imagine it's things like silver, small things that people could probably carry easily. So we did some of the looting as well, we did. Americans.
Paul Jennings is an interesting character. I'm glad you brought that back up. I read his memoir. Paul Jennings was the young enslaved boy who worked for Madison. He would live a long life and record this and was, somewhat literate. And his recollection was when Mrs. Madison and the entourage fled on a wagon and a carriage with the portrait of Gilbert Stuart portrait, the copy. They left him back. He was out at the stables afraid as people were busting out doors and windows and looting. And it pained him to see this. He later sets off at night in this, chaotic rabble of looting. He's this young former slave boy, sets off at night, finally finds his way to safety. But yeah, he described a pretty harrowing scene there.
Mm-hmm. And there is, during FDR's administration, there was a descendant of a British soldier named Thomas Keynes, who had, according to the provenance, had taken a medicine chest. So the British weren't faultless in this. They did participate in the looting as well. And of course, it sounds like they enjoyed the meal that Dolly Madison set out that was supposed to celebrate the victory of Bladensburg, but
they did. Coburn.
They didn't want it to go.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Matt.
I was gonna say they probably just didn't want it to go to waste.
Yeah, there it is. Dolly, before she had fled, she was anticipating a glorious victory at Bladensburg, so she wanted to celebrate and imbue everybody with a sense of victory. So she had a massive meal set. The British found it sitting out for them. Of course, these soldiers have been marching. They enjoyed the feast, and Coburn, the rough, tough, honorary admiral, couldn't help but making fun of the Madisons. They took Madison's sword. They took a lot of things. He made a joke about Mrs. Madison's posterior, and so the British were toasting the great little Madison and Mrs. Madison's posterior. So they enjoyed the dinner, and they sure did loot. Yeah, and some of that medicine chest came back to under FDR. Yeah, great. I'm glad you remembered that. Great story.
This is a good one. Oftentimes when we post things on social media, we'll hear commentary back about the retribution for the burning of York. But then there, and maybe you've heard this, there are people that want to argue about whether the soldiers were Canadian or whether the soldiers were British. So can you please end the debate for us all?
It was British regulars. They weren't Canadians. They were British regulars from the army that defeated Napoleon. Some of the most awarded and impressive soldiers in the entire Napoleonic theater. So they weren't Canadian. No maple syrup was found down there and no hockey sticks. So
that's good news for our neighbors to the north. Right. Jim wonders, what was the British deal they had made with citizens to not harm them if they were peaceful common, or were they just showing deference because it was the capital city?
So Admiral Coburn wanted to burn everything. He wanted to attack people. That was his temperament. But Ross was in charge. Coburn was older than Ross, but Ross was given charge of the mission. Ross was a gentleman. As he and his advance unit is marching down the street, he calls out for the few citizens remaining and promises he will not burn their houses or harm them if they don't attack him. They also find one guy is burglarizing, and Ross has this tough Scottish sergeant go get him, and the sergeant beats him and brings him back, and they arrest him like an MP. So Ross was serious about it. However, as he's parading down the boulevards through Washington, D.C., gunshots are fired from a house nearby, and it hits a couple of the British, and it hits Ross's favorite horse. Well, a military officer back then and their horse, that's fighting words. So Ross sent men, Coburn actually, the admiral, had some of his sailors charge in, and they burned that house down. The people that fired at them fled out the back, so they couldn't find them, but they did burn that house. one of the Ross's lieutenant, a guy named Scott, says no, but Coburn's aide says yes, that there was a house across the street that shots came from. So they also attacked that house. So one, maybe two houses, but they, Ross honored his word. He didn't want to be, you know, the barbarians at the gates, you know, that sack the library of, I mean, the great library at Alexandria or something like that. So Ross wanted this to be a gentlemanly thing. And there was really no strategic value to sacking houses. Rather, get in and get out. One of the reasons Ross left quickly, I mentioned the weather got bad. There was a freakish storm. More British soldiers were hurt, injured in the storm than in sacking the city. That's how rough the storm was. Roofs were blown off. A horse was knocked over. Also, Ross suspected it might be a trap, because if an enemy is, you know, military 101, if the enemy is marching into your city, you fell trees across the path. You set out, you know, picket lines and earthworks and trenches, things to slow the enemy and harass the enemy on their way in. None of that. So it seemed too easy. So Ross was a little unnerved, like maybe this is too easy. Maybe they're leading us into a trap. Again, he didn't have artillery that he needed, and he had a small force. So they wanted to get out lest they be trapped inside the city.
Mm. Well, we are at the close of our program. The book is When Washington Burned, available with Georgetown University Press. Robert, thank you so much for joining us for White House History Live. It's been a pleasure speaking with you. I enjoyed the program, and I know our audience did as well.
Thank you, Matt. And thank you, everybody, for joining and supporting the White House Historical Association. And Matt, thanks for all the good work that you do.
Now, before we end the program, I'd just like to let everyone know that our next episode of White House History Live will be at 5:30 p.m. on Tuesday, September 19th. Our speaker that evening will be C.W. Goodyear. We'll be discussing his new biography, James A. Garfield, From Radical to Unifier. If you'd like to watch any of our previous White House History Live episodes, please go to whitehousehistory.org. Thank you, everyone, for joining us this evening, and we hope to see you next time on White House History Live. We'll be right back.